Hi everyone, welcome back. Check this out. If you didn't quite catch what just happened there, from a completely arbitrary position, 1,000 blocks away in the nether, at basically any time you want, I was able to instantly transmit a signal to this wireless receiver, with absolutely no items. On top of that, all of the kinds of receivers that I've constructed around the world operate completely independently, which means say I want to go to a different location, all I have to do is find its very own angle, and teleport to that new position again. And also, by the way, since all of this teleportation is facilitated by enderpearl stasis chambers, and ever since very recent updates, enderpearls actually load chunks, you can also build these stations in the end too. And if I wanted to ever go there, all I have to do is find the end specific angle, and I'll be teleported there instantly as well. If you're kind of confused by what the hell you're actually looking at, that's perfectly understandable because what it looks like I'm doing is basically black magic, kind of technology that hasn't really existed since item shadowing was patched in the game. So, how exactly does this work? To kind of figure that out, we need to start with ghast fireballs because that's kind of where this all starts. Ghast fireballs were added, obviously, with the ghast, and you basically always had the ability to deflect them, which sends the ghast fireball directly straight forward in the direction that you're punching it in. This makes perfect sense, because what the ghast fireball's doing is essentially copying the direction that you're looking in, and, well, traveling in it. And this functions exactly the same for projectiles, only a little bit unintuitively. Instead of copying maybe the direction that the arrow is traveling in, it still just copies the direction that the player's looking, which means hypothetically, if you and the arrow happen to be looking in very, very different directions, you can get some pretty interesting results. The reason this really, really stupid bug that's been in the game for ages actually matters to us is because if we were to hypothetically control when this arrow collides with this fireball, no matter what point in space we are, no matter how far away or what dimension or any time or any of that, we actually can get this fireball to collect a very precise number about the exact direction that the player is facing, completely wirelessly. You might be able to see where this is going. So, all you have to do is design a device that shoots your own arrow. It has to be the player's arrow, it can't be one shot from a dispenser or anything, repeatedly at a fireball, or in this case a wind charge, because we can produce them automatically using breezes without the need for player intervention, and you have a device that's constantly collecting information about exactly where the player's looking. And as you can see, if I move around this chamber, it changes the direction that this breeze charge flies every time it's hit by this arrow. You might notice that it sometimes misses, that doesn't really matter since we're able to check so frequently. And as for actually causing the trigger event for the enderpearl stasis chambers, you just punch a really tiny hole in the cage at a very, very specific angle, and the wind charge will fly into that hole, hit a target block, and trigger a enderpearl stasis chamber. How do we actually get the wind charge? Well, the wind charge is generated by this breeze facing this iron golem, and it shoots breeze charges through this really tiny gap, which is detected by this piece of string, and successfully corralled into this small bit of flowing water, which directs it into the chamber. Basically, all this technology is derived from a very, very, very cool machine that was designed by a very smart person named Hectorus919. They have a very cool YouTube channel with a bunch of really, really creative designs, and what I did was I hot-wired their static wind charge generator V5, which is a very cool machine. I only actually ripped out the core, but the original machine is an absolute masterwork of engineering, in this tiny space fitting a device that allows you to actually program how many stacked wind charges you want to be outputted out of the front of the machine, and it'll automatically time everything and stack all the wind charges into a singular little pellet, which gets ejected out of the front. And having a lot of breeze charges stacked in a single location has a wide range of practical applications in the world of anything related to breeze charges, so massive shout out to Hector and all of their stuff. I wouldn't have been able to do any of this project stuff without basically stealing the core of their design. Before I talk a lot about the whole survival aspects of it and the potential applications on servers and whatnot, and all the practical nonsense associated with that, let's talk a little bit about the design process. I started with a machine that actually expended arrows originally to operate it. You'd have to inject individual arrows into the system because the breeze charge cage was actually really, really small, which meant that when the arrow landed on it, it would hit the breeze charge. The breeze charge would go somewhere, and then the arrow would get blasted away by the explosion and fly in some totally random direction. The reason why that's bad is because if the arrow is in a completely random spot, we don't know where it is, and we can't recover it, which means we need to keep putting new arrows into the system. Obviously, this kind of sucks. The next advancement was figuring out that if we could get the breeze charge to explode really far away from the arrow, it actually wouldn't knock it very far off course, so we just made the breeze charge cage really big. So now when the breeze charge actually gets hit by the arrow just falls straight back down into a collection chamber which can be lodged up again. Actually, putting the breeze charge in the chamber was done with a very primitive flying machine setup, which kind of just pushed it in. It's not very fast. This thing only was able to run about once every 11 seconds. The last advancement is that of the current design, where I just basically figured out that you could inject a breeze charge directly into the chamber using a water stream, as long as you were able to perfectly time your arrow shot such that it intercepts the breeze charge midair. And that requires a little bit of finicky nonsense, but with the right repeater timings, you can make it happen. Alright, now onto the fun stuff, which is what you can actually do with this crazy device. I decided to call it the mirror receiver, or the mirror, because it's very similar to using a magic mirror from Terraria, whenever you're just basically from any location just teleporting back to a specific waypoint. It also mirrors the player's angle of looking, so I just felt that the name was particularly fitting. In terms of the actual survival application, it's absolutely crazy that basically from any position at any time, you can instantaneously warp to a previously set up waypoint. Here I'm using a mod that allows me to snap my vision to certain angles of looking to find those precise angles a bit faster. And I've got a waypoint set up here in the Pale Gardens. I've also got one set up in the beach, which we've already seen. I also happen to have one set up in the jungle, as we've been spending a lot of time around. Or is that this position? Or this one here, I think. Right there. And also one in the end dimension. There we go. What sets this technology apart from all other existing portable wireless devices, such as Cat Tech, unloading fishing bobbers, or unloading chunk loaders by re-logging from the game, is that our system has multiple independent outputs that are connected to independent inputs, like angles in the sky. This means that we can individually choose to warp to individual locations completely at will. All other systems may have different stations all able to function simultaneously, but only allow one input, which is logging or retracting a fishing rod, or whatever it is. This device here also has the option to self-reset itself. This doesn't sound like that much of a benefit, considering if you're teleporting to a device, you should be able to reset it yourself anyways. But this does actually yield a lot more practical applications in terms of things other than teleportation. Let's say I'm in a very far-off location, and I have a mob switch at home that I really want to turn on. I can actually just look at a particular position in the sky to turn it on, look at another one to turn it off, and I can do this any amount of times because the machines are completely resetting themselves independently from any position, allowing me to turn on and off mob switches, basically with complete full rein, like I have a remote in the back of my pocket. In terms of multiplayer functionality, I'm obviously doing all these tests in single player, but it does have a lot of promise in multiplayer. If you want to see that stuff, check the description. Much more details there because it gets super complicated. Now, I'm going to spend the last part of this video talking about probably an issue that you've already written in the comments about, and it's that by building a variety of these machines, you've essentially filled the upper part of your vision with landmines that you now have to avoid. Let's say you accidentally cross over the position that triggers a teleporter when you don't want to, and then you're automatically teleported to that location, completely out of your will, accidentally. This seems like a big issue until you consider the fact that, number one, you're actually not very looking in the sky very often anyways. That's why I chose to put the triggers up there instead of down there where you're actually doing a lot of stuff. But also, the actual spot in that you have to look is so incredibly tiny that you're incredibly unlikely to flash your vision across it at the exact moment a breeze charge contacts an arrow. If you're still not convinced, it would be incredibly easy to implement a system that waits for 2 to 3 triggers of the machine, so you'd have to be staring in that exact particular location for up to 10 seconds in order to trigger the device, basically ensuring that you're never going to trigger it accidentally. Alright, that's all I have for you today. Make sure to subscribe if you like this kind of content. If you actually want to experiment with design, I'll put a world down in the description. Make sure to actually read the description. I'll include a bunch of technical jargon in there that you probably need to look at if you want to use this machine for yourself. Also, if you do make any changes that fix some of its many flaws, make sure to swing by the Discord. Tell me about it. And I'll see you next time. Make sure to subscribe, and bye-bye.